Hello, I'm your host Chris, and welcome to a special six-part episode of Comic Tropes. They've been known as everything from the Infinity Stones to the Soul Gems, but comics readers know them best as the Infinity Gems. Six objects of power that each control an aspect of existence, and when combined, grant its wielder the ability to do anything imaginable. Yeah, in 1990's Thanos Quest, it was explained that they were once part of a cosmic entity that became lonely and exploded into these six disparate parts. But what do they each do? Who have been their wielders over time? I'm going to explain all of that, the comics history specifically, so that you can compare and contrast with the comics you may know or the movies themselves. Get ready to understand the nature of the Infinity Gauntlet. The Time Gem first appeared in 1977's Marvel Team-Up issue 55, alongside the debut of the Power Gem. In that story, the being known as the Stranger held the Power Gem and was hoping to gather more gems. It led him to a special part of the moon that had an atmosphere, where the gem he sought was held by the Elder of the Universe known as the Gardener. But the superheroes Spider-Man and Adam Warlock also happened to be there, and along with the Gardener, drove off the Stranger. The gems were used together in several plots before again being in the hands of the Gardener when Thanos went out to gather them all in a bid to become omnipotent. He went after the Time Gem third and used the Power Gem to both escape Gardener's plants and overpower Gardener such that his plants killed him. Thanos then went on to use the Time Gem against the Elder known as the Runner, aging him millions of years so that he could steal the Runner's Space Gem. Thanos then used the Time Gem to turn Runner into a helpless baby in a trade with the Elder known as the Collector for the Reality Gem. Before leaving the Collector, he allowed the Runner to return to his normal age, leaving him fighting the Collector. Thanos, Nebula, and Adam Warlock each briefly held the Time Gem as part of the Infinity Gauntlet, but Adam distributed the gems to his friends for protection. He gave the Time Gem to Gamora, who admitted she really wouldn't know how to use it properly. In the title Warlock and the Infinity Watch, the gem was eventually held by Gamora's amnesiac teammate Maxim. Gamora didn't trust Maxim, which led to her quitting. Adam gave the gem to Maxim. The Time Gem restored Maxim's memory that he was from the future. He had come back in time to stop Warlock from becoming an evil future version of himself that ruined the universe. The fight was quickly stopped by Moondragon's use of the Mind Gem. After the Time Gem fell into the hands of Rune the Vampire and Galactus the Eater of Worlds, the Time Gem next was gathered by the secret superhero group called the Illuminati, who divided the gems up for protection. Namor the Submariner was given the Time Gem. He later went to take possession of it when the criminal called the Hood was trying to steal the gems. Namor, Red Hulk, and Thor went to Namor's underwater vault, and Namor entrusted Thor with the Time Gem for safekeeping. After the Avengers defeated the Hood, Iron Man made the combined gems, in the form of the Infinity Gauntlet, disappear. The gems were secretly returned to the Illuminati, and Namor again protected the Time Gem. Later, parallel worlds began destroying one another in events called incursions. The Illuminati reassembled the Infinity Gauntlet, and Captain America used it to push a parallel world away. Five of the Infinity Gems shattered, but the Time Gem blinked out of existence. Captain America feared the Illuminati would go on to make decisions to actually destroy parallel universes, so Doctor Strange wiped his memory. Later, Captain America remembered what had happened and gathered some fellow Avengers to confront Iron Man. Then the Time Gem reappeared and began sending the group forward through time. In each jump, an Avenger was returned to the present while Captain America was thrust forward, learning that the Avengers went on to become fascist, actually controlling a planet 5,000 years in the future. Having learned the dangers the Avengers could represent from the Avengers time-traveling villain Kang, Captain America returned to his time and the gem went away. A final incursion eventually destroyed the Marvel Universe, but it was reborn thanks to the efforts of Mr. Fantastic. When reality was rebuilt, the gems changed color. The original Time Gem was orange, but now it was colored green like in the Marvel movies. The gems were thrown throughout the universe, and the Time Gem was found on the planet Sakaar, formerly a desolate planet where the Hulk had once fought in gladiatorial matches in the Planet Hulk storyline. The Time Gem had begun to restore Sakaar to life. The Super Skrull obtains the Time Gem in hopes to restore his empire. The Time Gem allows its user to move through time, freeze time, age or de-age opponents, or see through time to potential futures. Though it has been held by many, few have accessed its power, aside from using it alongside the other Infinity Gems, where it can allow its holder to exist everywhere at once. So that's the full comic book history of each gem. I don't know, maybe I could have combined this all in one longer episode. I tried to break it up, but I know that there's some repetition. So this was a little bit of an experiment. That said, now that the recap portion is done, I do want to offer some of my thoughts on what I consider the highs and the lows of the Infinity Gems being used as a story device. I think that the Soul Gem is definitely the strongest storytelling element out of the six gems. I think that a lot of those early stories featuring Warlock, written by Jim Starlin, they're interesting. You know, it's soap opera, space opera stuff. It has metaphysical aspects to it. It's trippy. It really fits its 70s vibe. Like, that early 70s stuff is really entertaining. I think it holds up very well. As some of the other Soul Gems were added, I think it was a little bit diminishing returns. I mean, certainly stuff like the Space Gem allows teleportation. The Mind Gem allows telepathy. Well, those are quite common powers that we see in other superheroes. So as a plot device, they're not that unique. The Power Gem, it tends to end up in the hands of already super strong beings, so it just sort of exaggerates their strength. The Time Gem is potentially very interesting because it allows for sort of time travel stories, but those stories are trickier to plan ahead for, so I don't think it's really been used that much. The Reality Gem could be interesting, but that sort of is the same idea as Marvel's Cosmic Cube. That's a device of power that allows its holder to sort of grant a wish or rewrite reality. So it's sort of derivative of that idea. I feel like the Soul Gem is definitely the strongest idea out of the six, and that some of the others just aren't that strong. I think that when combined into the Infinity Gauntlet to give its wielder, you know, omnipotence, I think that that was interesting once. In the Infinity Gauntlet series, it's interesting for a villain to control that power once, and I think it's interesting for the heroes to control that power once, as the Illuminati does in later Avengers issues. But both of those have something in common. Before the Infinity Gauntlet six-issue series, Jim Starlin was writing Silver Surfer and had about 2 years of buildup to that story. As Thanos learned about the gems, as he became a bigger cosmic threat, and we learned the nature of the gems, you know, that was really built up to. And then when the Avengers became aware of these gems, that was at least 2 years, it was probably more than 2 years, more like 3 years, of build-up to the Secret Wars event, where parallel universes were crashing into each other. And that was interesting, because now we're focusing on the stories of how far is a hero willing to go to protect their world? Are they willing to potentially kill or do something, you know, immoral to protect what they consider the greater good? And what is the greater good? So the Jim Starlin Silver Surfer issues through Infinity Gauntlet I consider a highlight. I consider the Avengers and New Avengers titles that Jonathan Hickman was writing, building up to and including Secret Wars, I consider that a very strong storyline. A lot of the stuff in the middle, which is mostly 90s stuff, you know, the Infinity War, the Infinity Crusade, Adam Warlock and the Infinity Watch, some of the other appearances of the gems, I don't think that they're that great. I don't think they stand out in a unique way. I don't think they take full advantage of what they're supposed to be. I think the Cosmic Cube stories tend to be more interesting than giving a villain omnipotence. So that's my take on it. I definitely would recommend a lot of the earlier Jim Starlin stuff from the 70s through the 90s, and then I would recommend Jonathan Hickman's work on Avengers and New Avengers, starting somewhere around 2014. He wrote both titles concurrently and spent several years building up to Secret Wars. Really good stuff. That's just my opinion. Yours definitely may vary. Maybe there's a small story in there that you really enjoyed, like one of the Marvel team-up issues or Avengers Annual 7, something like that. And that's totally fair. This is just my take on the material. I think you look at Thanos, and he's interesting building up to omnipotence once. And then there's sort of a redemption storyline, and that's fine. But when he keeps trying to assemble omnipotence just to win over death, he starts to come across like some sort of weird incel. You know, he's an involuntary celibate that's just cranky at the entire world that he can't get a girl. And it becomes depressing. I think it's more interesting in those early issues, even though he was trying to win over death, he also explained that he believed that the world only had so many resources and there were too many sentient beings, and he wanted to have that to make the world a better place. Now, that's insane. That's genocide. That's crazy. But you can at least understand where he's coming from, that he's, in his mind, trying to make the world a better place. That's an interesting angle, and I think that's sort of been left behind over the years. But he did explain that as his belief system, like I believe it was in Silver Surfer in the late 80s, early 90s. So anyway, that's my take on what I like the most. I appreciate you sticking around. Next week is episode 100 for me, like just in terms of official episodes. I've done all sorts of extra content. But 100 episodes of Comic Tropes. It's been almost 2 years that I've been doing this weekly. I hope you will tune in for that. I'm going to try to make it something special. Thank you for watching, and until next time, keep reading comics. Please keep in mind that I have a Patreon. You can see it right there. We have all sorts of rewards at different tiers. Everything from exclusive blog content to early access to episodes. Exclusive episodes sometimes, polls to decide on topics for the future. So if you're of a mind, please consider taking a look at that. I appreciate everybody's support there. What else? Oh, we got 2 entries of fan art this week. If you want to submit fan art, you can send it to comictropes@gmail.com. I will show everything that gets here, and then I will pick one of those people to randomly receive a Gachapon prize. I picked up a ton of Gachapon in Japan a while back, and every week somebody randomly wins one. This week we have 2 entries. We have this beautiful piece from Jeremy Landry. I love it. Fantastic work. Thank you so much. I'm honored. And we also have this piece by Miles Durkee. Miles had an interesting story where he says that he has a disease that keeps him from using his hands very well. And he used to love to draw, but he can't do it very often. But he was inspired, and he contributed that piece because, you know, he just felt like it. So, you know, I appreciate that. I appreciate both pieces quite a bit. So I'm going to flip this coin to see whether Miles or Jeremy wins. Let's see. We'll say Miles sent his first, so he'll be heads. Jeremy sent his second, he'll be tails. Let's see. It is tails. Tails. I'll put that up there. Okay, so Jeremy, you win the Gachapon prize. And I'm going to reach in here. This is, you know, I'm trying not to open it and ruin it for anybody, so let's see. But it looks, oh, it's One Piece. It's something from One Piece. I did an episode about that recently. That's a very popular manga. It looks like it's some sort of unique keychain. So, Jeremy, I will be in touch to get your address. I'll be sending this out your way. All right, everybody, I appreciate you watching. Next week, episode 100. Maybe I should do something special for it.